Welcome to Cal Discovery's Travel, and I'm welcoming all of the Cal Discovery's travelers and friends back to another virtual experience with one of our distinguished lecturers. This will be presented in our Cal Discovery's Travel Lecture Series on our website coming soon, and I am Nancy McNeil, Assistant Director of Cal Discovery's Travel. Today, I'm so excited to be interviewing Dianne Fukami, an Emmy Award-winning documentary and television producer, and a graduate of UC Berkeley School of Journalism. Hi, Dianne. We'd like to have you today just continue on with your experiences and share some of the wonderful things that make you who you are and why, as a lecturer, our travelers have really enjoyed traveling with you.
Hi. Thanks so much, Nancy. And I guess I should start out with Go Bears, right?
Excellent. I like that idea. Go Bears.
And anyway, I've had such a fun time the last 3 or 4 years working with Cal Discoveries. Nancy, as you know, my last 3 trips have been to Japan. A little bit about myself. I've been to Japan about 20 times. I've been a TEDx speaker and able to convey some of my experiences through that about going to Japan. In 2006, I made a 3-year commitment to work with Link TV to work on their Muslim American project. And it was a fascinating experience for me. It happened shortly after 9/11, and the initiative was about the challenges that Muslim Americans face in a post 9/11 world. And I got so much insight into Islam and Muslim Americans and was able to kind of compare it with the experiences that my own family had faced being incarcerated as Japanese Americans in World War II. So that's a little bit about myself currently. Oh, I'm sorry, just a couple of more things. My most recent project was a film that was shown on PBS nationally, really proud about that, about Norman Mineta. And we called it Norman Mineta and His Legacy, An American Story. It was broadcast nationally on PBS last year in May. And I'm currently on the faculty of the Academy of Art University, and I teach TV and multimedia.
Excellent. Thank you, Dianne. And congratulations on the nationally broadcast documentary back in May. All righty, we're going to continue on here with some of our questions. What has been your association with Cal and or the Cal Alumni Association?
It started pretty early. I was a Cal Alumni Scholar for my 4 years of undergraduate work over at Cal. And so I was the beneficiary of many people who so generously donate to the Alumni Society. As you mentioned, I graduated from the School of Journalism, and I'm a lifetime Cal. I have a lifetime Cal alumni membership, which I'm pretty proud of. And then I've been a Cal Discoveries lecturer for 4 years.
Wow, you've certainly been involved and supported the Cal Alumni Association and Cal Discoveries Travel. Thank you so much, Dianne. Well, you have mentioned that you've been on several trips with us, and I know that you've traveled extensively, but let's focus on one of the Cal Discoveries trips where it was maybe one of your most, you had your most unexpected, humorous, and or memorable experiences with our Cal Discoveries travelers.
This had to have happened on one of the trips to Japan. So, you know, one of the wonderful things is that everybody gets to experience things outside their comfort zone or things that they never had a chance to be exposed to before. I use the word expose quite literally and figuratively, as you'll soon find out. So during this Japan trip, we stay at a ryokan, which is a Japanese country inn. And, you know, you sleep on the floor, you have the total Japanese experience, including the ofuro, which is known as the Japanese sort of public baths. I use the word public loosely because it's really just for guests of the ryokan there. And so, well, I was explaining to my fellow travelers the protocol in using an ofuro, because what happens is that, you know, you take off your clothes and you have to cleanse your body before stepping into the bathwater itself. And it's a, you know, it's like a small swimming pool, heated. A lot of it is natural springs. And as I'm explaining this complicated procedure to our travelers, they look at me and they said, well, will you go in with us? And so luckily, you know, the ofuro is segregated by gender. And I said, sure, why not? So I never expected to go, you know, have an experience with my fellow travelers in my birthday suit, as we all were. But it, you know, it's something that really makes you have a better understanding of the culture, and it sure was fun.
Wow. Yes, quite unexpected, Dianne, and I'm sure that the willingness on the part of the travelers came a lot from you agreeing to go right in there with them in your birthday suits. You never know sometimes what to expect on trips. I've had the same experiences. Let's talk a little bit about what your philosophy is concerning the role of an enrichment lecturer.
When I go on these trips, you know, part of it is my journalistic background, but I try to research everything. And what I want to provide to the travelers is information that they wouldn't necessarily get from a guidebook, nor would they necessarily get from the local guide that we use at each stop that we go to. And so I do a lot of research and I try to explain and give context. So in Japan, for instance, you know, a very important difference between American and Japanese society is the difference between we and I. Japan is much more of a we-based society. You know, what's good for everybody is good for the individual. Whereas, you know, as Americans, we haven't been brought up that way. It's much more of an individualistic thing. But if you understand that concept, you understand a large part of where the Japanese are coming from. So similarly, you know, I'm planning to go on a trip on the Silk Road in 2021. And so what I've done so far is a lot of research, a lot of watching other people's videos, and also have contacted a native in Tashkent who's agreed to meet with us and go out to dinner with us and talk about, in a very candid way, Uzbekistan, both pre and, I'm sorry, I was going to say pre-Soviet, but we have pre-Soviet and post-Soviet life there.
Great. Great research. I know from speaking with, well, from speaking with all of our lecturers, actually, since that's my primary job, I know that you all spend an enormous amount of time not only preparing your lectures, your topics, but also really delving into the culture and just everything about a trip that lends itself to a very strong educational component. We really, really appreciate that. And so do our travelers. Let's talk about another trip again. What was your favorite trip and why?
Well, you know, with Kel Discoveries, I've only been with them to Japan. So the Silk Road will be my first non-Japanese experience. What I love about Kel Discoveries is that even though I've been to Japan 20 times or so, it gives you access to experiences and places that you might not ordinarily have. And I thought it was, you know, I pretty much knew a lot about Japan. Going with the travelers, what I was able to do was experience things that I had not known were accessible to me. So for instance, we participated in a Japanese calligraphy workshop. We went to a Buddhist temple in Japan, and we went to the market in the morning and did shopping and then prepared a vegetarian Buddhist meal that we all shared together. And then during one of the tea ceremonies that we were able to witness and participate in, we each were able to hold a $10,000 precious Japanese teacup. And believe me, as a regular tourist, I would never have had the opportunity to do things like that.
Wow. That would be very special. Pardon my voice. $10,000 teacup. I'm assuming it's made of gold?
Not all of them were made of gold. They had some gold leaf in them, but you know, everybody had to take off their jewelry on their hands so that your rings wouldn't accidentally chip or, you know, cause any damage to the teacups. We were all really scared. Frankly, I would rather not have touched the teacup.
I'm surprised they didn't make you sign your life away, Dianne.
Pretty much.
Thank you for sharing that. Very, very interesting. Well, you know that, friendships are made along the way on these trips. You do some very fun things together, some unexpected things together that draw you together. Can you tell us about ongoing friendships that you and other travelers have made?
You know, I was so surprised during my first Cal Discoveries trip. My husband and I don't do a lot of group travel. We like to think of ourselves as independent travelers. Well, first of all, the Cal Discoveries trip was one of our first group travels, and it was wonderful. You know, everything's taken care of you. But what really impressed me is the people who were on my trip or our fellow travelers, and many of them had been on multi-trips together. You know, they had become friends on a previous trip, really enjoyed each other's companies, and have decided to travel in pairs for the most, you know, two couples together. And some of these people they were traveling together for, this was like their fourth or sixth trip. And so these are friendships and relationships that really endure. And I can really see that after spending time. You know, since we've come back, we've had reunion dinners. I've been to the home of a couple on one of my trips in Paso Robles. We had lunch together. A San Diego couple flew up to the Bay Area, and when they were in town, we had dinner together. It's, you know, these are people that you enjoy, and you can have relationships for life. And it was really pretty unexpected, but quite wonderful.
Oh, I'm so glad you mentioned that, Dianne, because I'd like our viewers to know that this is just not something that happened on Dianne's trip. This happens all the time on our trips, where our travelers not only connect with one another, they connect with our lecturers, they connect with our tour directors, and it does make for a very, very unique, special kind of trip. And you know that Cal Discoveries Travel sets itself apart from other educational tours by connecting the excellence of Berkeley through distinguished faculty lecturers such as yourself. And you have the pleasure of traveling together to see some of the most iconic places in the world. Where are you looking forward to going next, and why?
Well, there are a lot of places that I would like to go, but I'm scheduled to go on the Silk Road with Cal Discoveries in October of 2021. Really looking forward to it. You know, it's not something that initially jumped into my mind, but the more I thought about it, the more I was taken with the idea. You know, one of the wonderful advantages about it is that it's not very well traveled by Westerners yet. And so the adventurous, pioneerish part of me is thinking, wow, I get to see places that a lot of people don't even have on their radar. You know, we're going to stay in a yurt. We're going to go in a four-wheel drive across part of the desert. We're going to be on a camel. It sounds pretty exciting, and I can hardly wait.
Great. Well, we are keeping our fingers crossed for all of our travel to come back to us sooner rather than later. Thanks, Dianne. And thank you for being with us today and for letting us get to know you on a more personal level. And we're hoping that this interview has brought you, the viewer, an exciting educational world of Cal Discoveries Travel. This is a wonderful place to be. Please visit our website at alumni.berkeley.edu/travel, where you can see our incredibly diverse 2021 program lineup, including Dianne's Along Central Asia Silk Road, departing September 28th through October 14th, 2021. I want to thank you for joining us today, and may you and your family stay healthy and safe during these uncertain times. Thanks for joining us.